What's up, guys? My name is Tim, and you guys are watching the Backyard Boys YouTube channel. And if you guys are new to this channel, consider smashing that subscribe button. But if you guys are OG to this channel, you guys know exactly what this is all about. We buy wrecked cars from Copart and IAAI all over the globe, and we get them back to their original beauty. And in this episode, we are starring a 2018 Nissan GTR. The reason why we brought this one here to the channel is because the other one that we just recently revealed, we're probably not going to follow through with it. We're going to most likely use it for a parts car or a drift build or something crazy. You know, I just don't know what exactly we're going to do with that car just yet. So we're going to continue with this build. And this one here has a lot more content. It is a facelift and it is absolutely gorgeous. I did want to show you guys just a little bit of this side damage. It does have more damage out front. Yes, it's pretty bad, and it reminds me of my blue GTR because it had a similar damage right over here. My blue one was sideswiped, and I had to replace basically this whole entire side, repair the rear bumper and the hood. I did replace the front bumper on mine. But anyways, with this one here, what we got to do right now, first thing is get it unloaded. And the reason why I wanted to show you guys this side of the damage is because it's going to be against the bushes, and I won't really be able to film it for you guys. And the reason why it's going to be up against the bushes, or just in general, we got to get it unloaded right now, is because this front end over here has some pretty darn bad suspension damage. So just going on this side here, I'm gonna show you guys a very nice in-depth video once it's on the ground, but take a look at that. Take a look at that. This wheel is just completely like mangled up, way worse than the Mercedes C63 video. Then we got the fender just destroyed way back here. Look at the gap here. It's not even like, I'm very afraid that there's some kind of apron damage here, which was not really noticeable in the Copart pictures. This door here is fine. Another thing I noticed right off the bat is the gap on the door. How come that gap is so bad? And look how it closes. I mean, has a very hard time closing. So maybe that apron is shot. Maybe the frame rail is something. What's up with it? I don't know just yet. But the car was hauled on a 9-car trailer, and this was facing the forward, so it got all the bugs and everything over here. We're gonna get it all washed up, don't worry about that. But right now, the first thing we gotta do is get this thing on the ground, because we can't even open the doors because the wheel wells for the trailer are not letting us open the door. So what we're gonna do is push this truck forward, get it unloaded on the pavement, that way we can start working on the suspension parts. First thing we gotta do is get this thing on its wheels, and let's start unloading it. Alrighty, ladies and gentlemen, we got the car on the ground, and if you guys saw those scenes, it was quite difficult, but we had to get it done. We used the jack, kind of just play with the trailer and the truck and just move it off the ground, and we got it exactly where we wanted it. And the reason why I showed you guys the quarter panel damage on the other side is because we can't really walk back there. But that quarter panel on that door was not really the scariest part on the car. That part of the car was pretty straightforward. I've done quarter swaps. If you guys do know my channel, you guys know that I've done a ton of quarter swaps, including that door. That whole entire side is pretty straightforward. Let's go ahead and head into the interior because the interior is quite different than a 2016 and a basically a pre-facelift. And I actually really, really love this interior. Going on into the interior, if you guys don't know, in 2017, GTR decided to facelift the interior, making some minor changes, which are actually very beautiful. If I'm not mistaken, the seats remain the same, but this whole dashboard and this layout over here is actually really nice. This panel seems to be the same as well, but this layout on the dashboard is really pretty and I am very excited to show you guys. Let's go ahead and step inside the car. And first thing we see different is just this whole entire infotainment center. Man, it's pretty, it looks much more modern and I love it. The one thing about my GTR I didn't really like was the infotainment center. It was kind of outdated and it was glitching and just the rear camera and everything on it was kind of eh. But going on to the facelift, it's really pretty. I actually really like it. It seems to have all the same functions. I mean, there really isn't much more stuff you can add, I guess, to this car, but it is really dirty in this car. And the reason for that is because the trailer wheel wells were in the way. We couldn't open the door. We had to crawl through the window. Therefore, we got footsteps all over here. Here, we do have a mirror and a broken headlight over there. But besides the fact, we got a current airbag that's blown right here. We do have a seat airbag that's blown right here and a driver airbag. Whoa, that just honked. It kind of freaked me out a little bit. But the dash itself seems to be the same as a regular GTR. Not regular, I mean the pre-facelift GTR. The steering wheel here is much different and is very gorgeous. I am happy that they updated it. It's really nice, much more modern, small airbag. And then we have some dry carbon fiber down here. It's nice, it's clean looking, it's pretty. The seats, like I said, I think they stayed the same, which is kind of hopefully, I mean, I wish they updated them, made them more aggressive, more modern looking. But going on to the rear seems to be pretty darn close to being the same as the pre-facelift. We have a Bose sound system over here. We have a part from the front bumper here. And I think the seatbelts are safe in the rear as well. So the current airbag here will be tucked back in. Well, the current airbag will be replaced, but the headliner will be tucked back in. That's not a big deal here. This seat airbag will be fixed and repaired by L&D Solutions. They're the guys that do all the insane work and make these seats look back to OEM. And looks like nothing ever happened, no accident or anything. And then they reload all the SRS modules and make sure the car is basically OEM. So the dashboard here has a little airbag cut out here, which is nice because if this blows, you don't really have to replace the whole entire dash. I like that, Nissan. Kind of looks a little funky, but it won't really catch your eye as much when you're driving or anything. It's not the biggest deal. In general, the car is beautiful. It is very dusty and dirty, which we're gonna get it cleaned up a little bit right now. And then obviously once the car is finished, we're gonna get the whole entire thing, you know, walked through and made sure everything is nice and detailed. What do we got here? We have some rib nuts, looks like. And then we have a Nissan manual. And yeah, I don't see anything cool in here besides the manual. So yeah, that's just about it for the interior. I did notice a little downside on the driver's seat, which I will show you guys right now. We do have a little burn hole right here. And I don't know what that is from, but I know this piece right here comes off pretty darn easy. See how it just kind of, you can see kind of the skeletal part of the seat right there. Apologize for the bad lighting. I do know we can get this thing repaired pretty easy and maybe change this color of this thing. It kind of would look good, think about it. So we're looking at the seat, you know, and then you can see a little like a, I don't know, maybe a red or something inside there, kind of make it, give it that sportier look. But then we'd have to change this. I don't know, we'll see what the future does. And as for the bark or whatever this is inside the car, it's kind of wet here as well. Maybe the window is open on the auction or something, but we got some tree. This thing did hit a tree according to Carfax, but that is it for the interior. It's pretty, it's nice, it's gonna get cleaned up and it's gonna be looking all brand new once we're done with it. And now guys, let's continue with the outside of the car. As for the outside in 2017, GTR decided to update basically what is the most visible stuff I can tell you guys besides the interior is the rear bumper, the front bumper, and the hood. The rear bumper is one of the best updates they ever did alongside with the front bumper. Man, they made this oval looking GTR into this sharp beast. Look at this over here, it just comes, flares out, you know, just kind of like makes the rear end way more square looking, and then it flares out to get this aggressive rear end. We do have the facelift taillights in here. We got exhaust tips, which are, I'm pretty sure those are stock. Carbon fiber piece down here, it's like a diffuser piece, which is carbon fiber. It's actually really stunning. This rear end is super fat, like it's just aggressive, like crazy. We got rear sensors and a rear camera. I mean, not much more to say about this rear end besides the fact that it's just amazing. The facelift edition is gorgeous. Whatever they decided to do, whoever designed this rear end, is gorgeous. Props to you guys. I think the first time I saw a facelift was on VTune's channel. I was like, okay, that thing is way better looking, in my opinion, than a pre-facelift. Go ahead and head to the front of the car. And I'll show you guys what we do have left with this bumper. So here's the bumper that was originally on the car. Go ahead and lift it up like this. The lip here seems to be pretty decent. I'm pretty sure we can salvage this lip, but the actual cover of the bumper is destroyed. Everything else inside the bumper seems to be fine. We got the fog lights, we got the sensors, and then you guys saw inside of the car, we do have this piece right over here. That's just about it. I mean, we do have a busted headlight. We're lucky that we have the computers, but I'm not sure that any of the computers survived at all. Let's go ahead and take a closer look into this car because we have not yet fired it up. And I'm a little bit afraid that it won't fire up. And the reason for that is because many people tune these GTRs, and when they throw them back on the auction, they take off all the parts. That is bound to be expected with these kind of cars. At the front end of the car, we see that the hood is damaged. This fender is just completely mangled. This hood may or may not be repairable. It is aluminum, so I'm not really like putting my hopes in repairing it. But if we do get it straightened out and it repairs, I'll be very happy. The first thing we do when we get a car from an auction is we assess all the damage. So usually, like, we'll take a good look at it, and then off camera, we're gonna run all the numbers. Make sure everything is calculated, make sure all the repairs that we do, they can be repaired back to OEM spec. That way, when we do sell the car or anything happens, we do know that the car is original spec. We're not worried about anything. We're not hiding anything. That's the first thing we do, and make sure, and we make sure it's worth it. So this is basically going around the whole entire car and taking a look at every single piece of damage. And then let's take a look up under this hood. First thing that pisses me off is, come on, Nissan, you guys could have made a hydraulic strut for this. Like, seriously, we're not reducing that much weight by that. Right now we're charging the battery because the battery is completely dead. But I did notice that we had an ethanol content analyzer over here, which shows us the amount of E85 inside the gas tank. Is that a good thing? I don't know. Why? Because we do have stock intakes on here. We do have everything, basically stock charge pipes, stock intakes, but we do have a fuel flex center sensor right here. If I'm not mistaken, that's what that is. Fuel flex sensor. And then if I'm also not mistaken, we might have some aftermarket injectors in there. I'm not sure if GTR can run flex fuel with stock injectors. Don't fact check me. I don't know these cars that darn well just yet. Although, yes, we've had a lot of them. It's time to start knowing them. But got a destroyed core support right here. This is part of the core support is destroyed. Here's the headlight bracket on the core support. And this core support, guys, is not cheap. We've looked it up. It is about $1,700 for a core support. $1,700, that's just insane. We're not, right now, what we're gonna do is actually take off this wheel because I don't know why. Is it sitting on the floor or something? Anyways, this wheel here is completely destroyed and it smashed the fender over here. We're gonna take the fender off, take the wheel off, and assess all the damage up in there. Make sure the subframe is not destroyed, because if it is destroyed, then we're gonna have to buy a new subframe because this car here is gonna be back on the road. But the steps to get it back on the road is, first of all, get it on its feet. Second of all, get it inside the frame bench and basically make sure the motor runs. Actually, sorry, that's the step before the frame bench, is make sure the motor runs. Those are the two main things, because that way we can drive it up on the frame bench. Getting up on the frame bench without the motor running is very, very, very hard, especially if the suspension is destroyed and on gravel. So let's go ahead and pull this wheel off, and then we can take this off here and take a look at that. Oh my goodness. Look at that. Okay. All right, well, that explains a lot. That explains this right here, why the fenders overlapped by about 1.5 to 2 inches. That explains a lot, but it looks scary. It looks very scary. Take a look at that. That right there is definitely scary, but I know that we can get that all pulled out. Why? Because it seems to be that the frame rail is completely straight, and this apron section is much weaker than a frame rail. So if we grab it right over here with our frame clamps, you know, with our frame machine, we can get a good, nice tug on it. And in theory, everything should come out. But you guys will only see that in future episodes, because we do need to order parts and get this thing on its feet as much as we can. It doesn't seem like anything really cracked over here. It just seemed like it buckled. And if it buckled, we can get that buckle right back out, hoping to basically get this back into his factory spec as much as we can. Our main goal is to pass inspection or pass alignment, make sure the fender bolts on, and make sure all this stuff is seam sealed, watertight, and looking absolutely OEM. This is gonna be a fun one, I'll tell you that much right now. I'm still curious on what this fender liner and this wheel here is hiding, because as I just showed you guys, this thing is destroyed. We're gonna pull the fender off, pull the wheel off, and continue inspecting all the damage. Let's do it.
Damn.
What in the world, dude? Look at that. That's crazy.
Maybe we could get it welded up?
That thing's so, dude.
That thing's freaking warped.
Yeah, I'm gonna keep this as a trophy, dude. This front face is all clean. Okay, let's take this fender liner off before we do much more inspection, because who really knows what's happening under here now. All right, well, in the last sequence of video, what you guys saw me doing with the charge pipes and the intakes, basically what I was doing is making sure that everything was connected, because it seems to be that the old owner returned all these top parts back to stock. And the car's been sitting for about 3 weeks or so, we haven't worked on it. And in those 3 weeks, we actually got some parts for the car, that way we can continue with the videos. One thing we did find out, which is completely mind-blowing, is the fact that this car here is 1,000 horsepower. To find out more, you guys are gonna have to stay tuned, because I'm still myself finding out everything about the car. Right now, we're gonna go ahead and try fire it up. But before we try fire it up, let me show you guys the suspension damage. Over here, it seems like the knuckle itself is safe. I did take a look at it, and the wishbone. But the strut, the lower control arm, the inner outer tie rod, the axle, and then the brake line here is pinched. We're gonna get all that stuff replaced. We also did, I think, get this right here, little stabilizer link. So we're gonna go ahead and get all that stuff replaced. And the apron here is not too badly destroyed. The alignment would be off before, you know, prior to pulling it, because it seems like the strut tower moved a little bit. But what I'm saying is that we can actually get the car on its feet and push it onto a frame machine. If not, hopefully drive it onto a frame machine. Over here, the firewall, we do have some pretty darn good damage, and that kind of makes sense on why this door here has a funny gap at the bottom and then kind of sticks out on the top. So the bottom section of the door was busted in over there. The firewall here needs to be all pulled out. We're gonna get all these buckles out. It's a lot of stuff here. We might actually change this outer shell, because I can see here bolts on, or not bolts on, it rivets on right here, spot welds on right here. So we might get all this stuff pulled out into its factory spec, get this piece replaced, and get this all looking OEM. Let's go ahead and try and give it a crank. Hopefully it starts. I didn't really have too much luck trying to start it last time, so let's give it a go. that is that. So that's the first crank. I did want to show you guys one thing though. Right over here, we have a little dongle that's just kind of loose. And I'm not exactly sure what needs to be connected because there's a mass airflow sensor down there that I think is mandatory to be connected. But I'm not sure how I can pair this up. It's just not working. I tried to connect all sorts of ways. Maybe someone in the comment section can help me out. Let's go ahead and try to reconnect this one rather than the mass airflow sensor and give it one more crank. Okay. I don't really want to kill the starter, but as you guys can tell, it is not firing up. And I think so is because of injectors. So we checked under the seats. It seems like it has some fuel pumps there for E85. It has an ethanol CANT analyzer. But all that stuff we'll be doing in the next episode alongside with most likely putting this thing on its feet. And well, the main goal will be to start it up first. That is gonna be it for this video. If you guys enjoyed this video, please leave a like down below. Comment your thoughts and ideas. Help me out a little bit. Try to get this beast started up. We are very excited because this is literally 1,000 horsepower. We've never had a faster car, and I'm very, very, very excited to feel the launches, the pulls, and everything. It's funny that the guy had some stock tires on it, and I talked to the stock, to the original owner. He said he made it a 9 or 10 second car with the stock tires. So that's pretty dang impressive. With all that being said, hope you guys enjoyed the video. Peace out, and I'll catch you guys in the next one.